Hey guys, how's it going? Hope you've been well. Today I'm answering a question that I get asked quite a bit, and that's, Mike, if you could only have one axe, what would it be? I'm holding the ubiquitous Gransfer's small forest axe, but this is not actually the axe that I would recommend if you could only have one axe, though it is a solid axe. Up front, I'm not that much of a woodsman, really. This is my yard. I live on a heavily forested acre, so I don't have a lot of land, but I have enough land to where I have quite a few dead trees or trees that I chop for firewood. I have a house with a wood-burning stove that I use all winter long. The house that I had before this also harvested my own firewood from the property and burned it in my wood-burning stove there as well. So I've used a lot of axes. I know a bit about them, and I use axes both for regular practical use, and then I keep axes in my vehicles as well for more overlandy wilderness use. So I'm gonna be coming at the axes from that perspective. Someone that uses axes a fair bit, but I don't do it professionally, and I want an axe that will still work good in a vehicle. Axes are cool. I think everyone should own an axe. They've been used as weapons for centuries. They have practical uses, especially if you live near trees, which is most people. If you go off-roading, camping, tons of great uses for axes. They're just good to have around. Great survival tool. Maybe your family is super anti-weapons. Get an axe. They can't really hold that against you. So I'm a big axe advocate. I think everyone should have a gun too, but axes are great. So this video is gonna be about axes, because you may not know about axes. You might not know what kinds to get. You might not know what brands to get. You might not know what models to get. And I'm gonna kinda help break that down. So I hope the video, like all videos I hope, are fun, informative. Maybe you'll learn something. I will link to all this stuff down below. And if you have any other questions that I don't cover in the video, definitely ask them in the comments down below. So I grabbed a few of my more kind of well-used axes. Some are axes proper. This one's a maul. We got some hatchets. We got some tomahawks. They all essentially are designed to do a thing. They have a sharpened edge made out of steel with a handle made out of wood or some type of polymer sometimes, or steel in some cases. And you swing them to chop, split, and separate wood. Tomahawks are more of weapons. Hatchets are more for light kindling work. So for the most part, I'm not gonna talk too much about tomahawks or hatchets, though there are some that kind of are called axes, but aren't really used so much to chop wood. Like this one is a cold steel axe gang, and it's used, could be used as a weapon or for throwing. So an axe like this, I don't actually use for chopping wood. This axe is a fun axe. So we're not gonna talk about that one. And then let's weed out a couple others. We got this one, which I like, it's a cool tool. The Gerber downrange tomahawk. I actually did a whole video on this one, but I don't really use this for wood. So that's out. This is a flagrant beard, really sweet tomahawk. I will link to all of these things down below as well. I also don't use this for processing wood. It's more of a weapon. This guy is, I believe, the Bear Grylls. Yeah, I don't know if they still make this, but Gerber still does make a tomahawk, or sorry, a hatchet of this design. This is, has some cool finger grooves you can choke up, has a little kind of hammer thing on the back. It's really nice for kindling, and I do really like this little hand axe, but it doesn't really tackle the big stuff, so this is also out. Then we have something like this. This is one of my main used axes. This is a Fisker's, it's the X27 splitting axe. But this is big, this is heavy, not really vehicle use, and mostly really just for splitting. I'm not gonna use this to chop down a tree or make kindling, so I'm gonna go ahead and put this out as well. Then we have the maul, which isn't really an axe. I do use this for splitting sometimes too. But let's take that out of the equation. And then we have kind of the Fisker's axes that I would say fall into the mix. This one's really a Gerber, but they are made by Fisker's, so we'll just call it a Fisker's. Fisker's axes made in Finland have a huge cult following. They are well priced. They're not indestructible, but they kind of say they're indestructible. They're hollow, some type of polymer handles. This is an older one. They both have rubber textures, but this one you can see kind of has some texture. This one's just smooth. The newer ones are like this. I like them better. This one, we'll just cut to the chase, is my favorite. It's the 28-inch chopping axe. Doesn't have rubber, but the polymer is texturized. So these are kind of the four axes we'll narrow it down to. So then let's cut one more out. We have the X15 and the X17, which look pretty much identical. They both have the same sheath carrying case kind of thing. I just tossed one on so you could see it. But one of these is a chopping axe and one of them is a splitting axe. Let me show you the difference. So we have the X17 on the left here and the X15 on the right here. And this will be true for pretty much all axes. A splitting axe used to split firewood is gonna have a wider, more pronounced wedge shape, whereas a chopping axe will have a thinner profile. Chopping axes can still be used to split, and splitting axes can still be used to chop, though they do excel at their specific tasks. The X15, the chopping Fisker's though, is more wedge-shaped than some of these other axes that we'll get into here in a second, which means it still splits quite a bit better than these other axes that are multi-purpose, even though it's called a chopping axe. So for the sake of a one axe kind of does it all, let's go ahead and get rid of this splitting axe, the X17, because while it does great for splitting, it is a little bit heavier, it's a little bit less portable, and not something that I would really want to make kindling or chop a tree down with. So then there was three. Don't worry about it. We're going to get into some of these other axes in a second, but I did want to narrow down the Fisker's. This one is small. It's a little guy. It is similar in size to the Gransfors Brooks small forest axe, but actually even smaller. I still think it's a great axe. If you have a car, if you're trying to pack light, something like that, you're not planning on really processing larger chunks of firewood. You don't think you'll ever have to clear a fallen log off of the trail, which is better with a chainsaw anyway. This is a good option. I would say it's better for kindling work and small stuff, but it can't handle some of the bigger tasks that these guys can handle. So not to say this isn't a great option. This one, funny enough, I do actually keep in my Subaru just in case, but it doesn't live in my truck. So, not a bad axe, but just because we're narrowing it down, let's go ahead and cut this one from the mix as well. That one is shaped similar in heads to the chopping axe. So it's kind of a general purpose utility axe. Okay, so while we talked about that Gerber being a little bit small, but still a good axe, that same theory applies to the Gransfors small forest axe. An amazing axe at an expensive price point and one of the most beloved axes in the world. If you are into axes at all, you know about this axe. Great axe. It's funny. Do you like my Amazon box backdrop? Great axe. I would recommend it as more of a backpacking axe. It's small. I split firewood quite a bit myself. I would never choose this. It would be it would be just above the hatchets and the tomahawks, but of my real axes, I would never use this to split wood. That's kind of a no duh, but just FYI, if you're really trying to get through some big stuff, you're gonna be sweating trying to use the Gransfors small forest axe. Great axe, but we are, and I hear the people crying now, we're gonna exclude this from the list as well. But don't fret, Gransford people, because we have the small forest axe's big brother, which is firmly in the mix for a great size and great quality. While we're talking about that, we've kind of narrowed down the axes, sizes, and shapes using the Fiskars series to help guide us. So we're down to two Fiskars, the longer 28 inch, and this is like a 23.5 inch, which is actually gonna be the smallest of the following axes that we're gonna get into. Okay, so if I could narrow down my kind of one axe does it all to five, they would be these five right here. Fiskars 28 inch chopping, Fiskars X15 chopping. This is the Gransfors Scandinavian forest axe, I think. This is the Husqvarna. It is the 27 inch, I believe. I think it's called the multi-purpose axe, or it might just be called the forest axe. Great axe. And then this one, which is another cheap option, kind of like the Fiskars. This is a cold steel trail boss, which falls into the size that I really like for a do-it-all axe for around the property or to keep in the truck. So if we are talking backpack stuff, you've heard my thoughts, some of these small guys will do okay. If you have the room and you can handle a little bit extra weight, all of these guys are great too. But assuming we have more room, let's go ahead and get this one out of the mix. This is the X15, great all around axe, can highly recommend. But if you have room for the 28 inch chopping, I'd recommend that even more. Okay, so then there were four. Okay, so these four axes, I can recommend all of them. Though they're all significantly different aspects, features, and price points, but they all have one thing in common. They kind of fall in this nice length that I like. A shorter axe is gonna be more dangerous because you can swing it. And if I'm swinging a smaller axe like this and I'm standing up and I miss and I swing and I keep swinging through and I keep swinging through, I can hit my leg. There are obviously ways to mitigate this. Swing and bend your knees as you're doing it. Go and be on your knees when you're swinging, but all that stuff equates to kind of more work. So these axes are more dangerous and they require more energy a lot of times to split the wood because they're smaller and because physics. They just don't have as much of a mass and you can't get as much velocity. And in general, they're somewhat more dangerous. They do lend themselves easier to one-handed work or fighting. So that is one thing to keep in mind. But these axes, my favorite axes, fall into a length where if you're swinging and you miss, they'll hit the ground before they hit you. Obviously, it depends on your form, technique, how tall you are, all of those things. But the longer the axe, the safer the axe for the most part when actually swinging it. Much like a pistol is much more dangerous, easier to shoot yourself than a rifle, something that is longer, harder to hurt yourself with. Same rule applies to axes. So these fall into the length that I like, both for safety, for ease of work. You're not having to bend over and reach down and get in all kinds of weird positions to use the axe. You can just use them like normal. The other thing is they're a little bit heavier heads, which means they would produce more power. We all learned this equation at one point of our life, E equals MC squared. That is energy equals mass times velocity squared. So you have two factors. You have mass, the weight of the head, and you have velocity, which is directly related to the length of your handle. The longer the handle, the more velocity you can achieve. The more weight the head is, the more massive, the more energy it will have. So this is a good balance of getting the maximum amount of energy. The edge and the shape, those all come into play. But as far as pure energy, these are a great happy medium. You have something like a maul with a nice long handle and a big heavy head. You can't swing it as fast, but it does make up for some of it with the mass, which can sometimes split firewood better, but it's all a balance, right? you're never going to have the energy of these smaller axes as you are with these more mid-size axes. Okay, so the Fiskars, this is the longest barely, very close in length to the cold steel on the left here. The longest and heaviest of the axes. It's not going to be your cheapest. The cold steel is going to be the cheapest, but this will be the second cheapest. Though, if you follow me on Instagram or anything, I posted this. This was on sale for $26. So at that price, it is the cheapest, but normally I think it's around $30 or $40. Still a great deal. I like Fiskars axes because of the plastic handle. That means you don't have to care about the weather, getting them wet, getting them in the rain. As a general rule, because of the steel, you still don't really want to leave them out in the elements all the time, but with the plastic handle, you can. It's also more durable than a wood handle. So if you're limbing a tree, or if you just miss on a split or whatever, drop it, it's not going to be chipped and broken as easy as its wood-handled brothers. So I do like the polymer handle. Also, it is, well, I think it's like some fiber-reinforced plastic, but I'm using polymer generically. Also requires no maintenance on the handle portion. You have a Gransfer's or even the husk or even the cold steel, which does come lacquered, so you could get the lacquer off. But these handles will come basically unfinished, so you're gonna wanna oil them with linseed or boiled linseed or tung oil or whatever you wanna use. I use tung oil, I like it. I'm not gonna get too far into that, but basically you oil the handles to make them more weather resistant, more wear resistant, so they don't break. So you make them stronger. The oil penetrates into the wood, polymerizes, and kind of bonds with the wood and makes it more impervious, but we are still dealing with the wood handle. You can achieve similar, not really the same at all results though, with lacquer or varnish, which is what I believe the cold steels come with. It'll be shinier and it won't penetrate quite as deep as like the oils will, but still, you know, not bad. These are all hickory handles, so they're pretty hardwood and they make great handles. You'll see now we have some different shapes of the handles. The Fiskars is very straight. The cold steel is pretty straight. And then these kind of have some whoops in them. And there's not necessarily one thing better or worse. It's more of a preference thing. These, some people will say more comfortable. The little angle may allow them to kind of get a little bit more velocity out of it. But preference. I like them both. What all the axes will also have is the swell here. So this is both to, when you slide your hand down the axe, to know your indexing point, as well as so the axe doesn't fly out of your hand as much. They all have them. My favorite, honestly, is the oversized one of the Fiskars. I love this. This really locks your hand in right here. This Grands and the Husk are very similar shaped. I like the Grands a little better. It's a little bit bigger. You can tell I like the bigger swells. So this is probably my second favorite axe, followed by the Husk. And then this doesn't have much of an actual swell. It's kind of a slow taper. Don't like it as much, but still works all right. So then let's get into heads. Fiskars, all mass-produced, machine-made, doesn't mean they're bad, just means that it takes a little bit of the art out of it and allows the price to get lower. Same with cold steel, these are mass-produced, all on a machine. Again, doesn't necessarily mean they're bad. But these two beauties are, people call them hand-forged, they're not really, they use a machine forge. But there is a person actually, you know, moving these heads around, probably with some tongs or something, so they are hand-shaped. But to clear up some misconceptions, it's not actually a guy like on an anvil with an actual hammer, like hammering these things. Not quite that level of hand-smithing going on. But your Husqvarna, oh, so this is around $30. Does not come with a sheath. You'll see the sheath we're missing there. These two come with sheaths, both of them I love, very minimal leather. I really like the Husk sheath for how minimal it is. And the Fiskars comes with more of like a handle sheath protector kind of dealio. Works great though, no qualms with that. I just wish it was a little less bulky. You can chop the top handle off if you want to make it a little less bulky, but I haven't done that. So these hand-forged babies here, you can see the shape is a little bit different between these two. This will have a bit bigger edge. The cold steel will have the biggest edge. This one is about in the middle, and this will have the craziest wedge shape. So it's shaped more like a splitting axe than the rest of these guys are. These two are very skinny heads, and you can see they're both kind of a similar kind of that hand-forged looking classic shape. So where the handle meets the head is an area of concern because we don't want it to come loose. A cheaper axe or even some expensive axes, the handles will come loose due to how they are handled. We don't want that. All of these axes have a pretty good track record of not coming loose. The Fiskars basically can't get loose. Grands are top of the line. Don't ever really hear about Grand's handles coming loose. Husks aren't actually made by Husqvarna. They're made by another forge. High quality axes. This is the cheapest, I don't know if I said it yet. This is the cheapest of kind of the hand forged axes available. The Husks. This is, if you want that kind of hand forged looks and the quality and kind of the heirloom quality that you can care for and pass down to your children, this is gonna be the easiest price to swallow. These are around 60 or 70 bucks. This guy is around 200, just a little shy of 200. So this is your high-end axe of the bunch. And then cold steels, I've heard pretty good things about. I actually like the cold steel and the Fiskars for limbing because I'll a lot of times just kind of golf swing the top and use this portion to clear branches off the top. If I remember, I'll show some overlay. I can do that with both of these. The cold steel is almost better because it's all steel. This one, this part is plastic actually. These ones I don't like to do that with because we got the little part sticking out the top and I don't really want to damage that. So these are kind of my more hard use limbers. That means taking the branches off of a tree. I like those. So here I have them laid out in the same order, cold steel, then Husk, then Grands, then Fiskars, to give you an idea of the kind of blade geometry. So we have the two kind of hand-forged axes are similar styles, though the Husk on the left of the middle is a little bit thicker, whereas we have the Grandsfurs, which is a little thinner. So I'm saying cold steel and Husqvarna and Grandsfurs and Fiskars generically. All of these companies make axes of different shapes, sizes, all kinds of stuff. But for the sake of, since we've narrowed them down to these four specific models, I'm just referring to them by their brand name. So the cold steel is kind of a little bit more wedge shaped, maybe a little thicker and really long. And the blade is actually really tall as well, if you can tell. Then we have the Husk left of middle here, which is a little thicker than the Grandsfurs. But still kind of that thin profile. Then the Grandsfurs, very thin profile. And then we have the Fiskars, which really, of the bunch, looks more like a splitting axe, though it is their chopping axe. But that's why the Fiskars is my favorite, because though it'll chop down a tree pretty easy, it'll make kindling pretty nicely, it'll limb a tree very well, it also splits the best of the bunch. You have a skinny blade like the Grands here, that'll split, any axe will split wood, but this will get stuck a lot easier, and it won't quite have that splitting power, splitting force that the Fiskars does. So while all the axes are great axes, and can certainly handle all of your tasks, the Fiskars is my favorite, both for the don't have to think about the handle, can get it wet, can leave it out, and even if I do break it or ruin it in some way, I'm not out that much money. So Fiskars is king for me in that regard. So having said all of that, Mike, the purpose of the video was to recommend us an axe. I would recommend the Fiskars as an all-around general use axe. Now the steel isn't gonna be as tough as some of its counterparts, but it's tough enough, you can sharpen it, holds an edge pretty well. That shape, that more wedge-like shape, makes it a far superior splitting tool to any of these other axes. But especially, it's designed, you know, it's called their chopping axe. It's great for chopping down trees. And for some of the reasons I mentioned before, great for limbing them as well. They do all have pommels, the kind of hammer side that you could use to hammer in a stake or something, but I wouldn't use them to pound on any super hard metal like axe to axe kind of stuff as a rule of thumb. But if I did need to use something and I broke the Fiskars, I'm not out a ton of money like I would be with the grands. So the Fiskars, I like it. I like the shape of it. I like the size of it. I like that the handle is polymer. I like that it's more weather resistant. I like, well, basically impervious to weather. And I like that it's more durable than the wood handle brothers. The thing is, there's nothing classy or classic or heirloom quality of the Fiskars. So if you're after that kind of classic type axe look, then you're not going to want a Fiskars. But as far as just usability and functionality, the Fiskars is great. Then we have the other axe over here, which is the Cold Steel Trail Boss. Another very cheap axe, $30. Pretty well made. Has that kind of classic axe look to it. A lot of people don't like that black paint, so they'll grind that off and make it look even kind of more classic. The blade shape, pretty big, decent for chopping, doesn't bite as well when I'm chopping, like chopping a tree, as these other two or this one, but it works. I would say this axe works the least good out of all three of these axes, but again, very cheap price. The thing that is a bummer about this axe is it does not come with a sheath. It comes with a little like rubber edge guard that I threw away, which is really for shipping. You could reuse it, but it'll rip on you pretty quick. So this axe, if you want a cheap axe that looks like an axe, that you could sand this down, you could put your own kind of stain on it and make it your own. Still a good axe. You can make a little sheath for it. I'm sure there's some companies out there that sell sheaths for them. But this, if you just need a beater axe, good option. But I would say this axe doesn't work as well as either of these other three axes. Then we have these two, which are very similar. It's gonna be just, it has the name, so you're paying some for the name, but also just a really high quality axe, arguably the highest quality kind of hand forged axe that you can get. Great handle, great shape. Wood grain is lined up just like it should be on the handle, though it is on the husk as well. Head shape is good. High quality, beautiful axe that you can pass down to your children if well taken care of. So both of these axes kind of meet that. This one comes in way cheaper. This is $60 or $70. This is like $190 or $200. So big price difference. So if you have the coin, the Grands Furs is gonna be a better axe, but the husk ain't bad at all. You can see once we get in here close, kind of the markings, it's not as nice and put together as the Grands Furs. Everything is very smooth and very nice on that guy. But not a bad axe either way. The Grands Fur has a little more personal touch. The axe maker's initials are in here, so those are all be different. BK did this one. MF did my small forest axe. And both of these sheaths are nice. Again, I do really like the super minimal nature of the husk, but the Grands sheath is nicer than a lot of the other ones that I've seen or tried out. So these two axes will have very similar characteristics and will last you a really long time. The husk has this little part here that you'll see on Amazon. A lot of people will, well, not a lot of people. You'll hear about all the ones that break, but they sometimes break, and they break right along that line. You rarely hear about a broken Grands, though they're more expensive. People probably aren't hitting rocks and stuff with them as often, but things to consider. So all around, the Fiskars, if you like that axe look and are looking for more of a beater axe, it will still do good. You know, you can sharpen it up, hold an edge decently well. And you need to make your own sheath. If you need a sheath, there's that. And then the two beauties in the middle, I really like them. Just know there will be more care and maintenance involved. You will need to oil the handles if you want them to last. You will need to treat the wood, oil the wood, take care of the leather sheaths if you want these to be heirloom tools. So hopefully that helps you narrow it down. I intended to make this video short, but as all my videos, it got quite long. All right, guys, that's it for now. I did pick up, there's this great deal. This is a 97 40th anniversary Land Cruiser 80 series. It's 97, it's triple locked, it's pretty sick. It's gonna be my new project rig because I got it for so cheap. So I'm super excited about that. unrelated to axes, but I did get another Fiskars to put in that. So I hope that this video helped kind of answer some of the axe questions you might have had. Again, it's not all inclusive. Axes, like a lot of other tools, are built for specific uses. And these are just kind of some general purpose axes. There's gonna be better splitting axes. There's gonna be better chopping axes. But these are kind of good general purpose axes. Hope that helped. I'm gonna link to them all in the video description. Using those links does always help support the channel as they're affiliate links, so I always appreciate that. If you have any questions, I'll try and answer them down below. And then just general questions, because a lot of my videos are like this one, where people ask me questions and I make videos about them, so I always appreciate your comments, even when they're unrelated to the video. Thanks for that like, thanks for the subscribe, get on that notification squad. I do post sales and stuff on my Facebook and Instagram and my kind of YouTube community page. I have a Patreon where I post even more deals when I kind of have exclusive stuff. So get involved in the Last Line of Defense community. A lot of rad people in it. Thanks for watching, and until next time, take care.